I don't have any like big story to tell, but there's one thing I do remember that I used to have a lunch box with Donald Duck and Pluto. It was a red color box, you know. I think my father must have got me some chocolates from somewhere. And I used to think they were real people. So, and in those days, in the feature films, they used to show a short animation film before the main feature. And we were staying in a very small town called Bharuch, which is on the river Narmada. And so every week the films used to change. And my thing was to go to see the movie because I would like to see the shorts. And then I used to tell my father to wait till the film, you know, everybody left the hall. So he said, why are you, the film is over, let's go. I said, no, I want to see them leave the theater. So I used to think they were real people and that, you know, at the end of it, we'll be able to see them, you know. One of my teachers in Baroda Fine Arts, Jairam Patel, he sort of suggested, why don't you go to NID to study animation? And I was not at all keen. I was more interested in painting then. But he felt that he said that animation was more than Donald Duck, that... you know, and we used to have a film society in Baroda, Darshan Film Society. And there I saw films by Norman McLaren and Caroline Leaf. And then I thought, wow, if this is animation, I want to do it. So that's how I went to NID. Actually, there were five of us who joined the first program, which was started in 1980. And it was conducted by Professor I.S. Mathur, then R.L. Mistry, and Claire Weeks. These were our main teachers. And of course, Vikas Sadvalekar was there. And, you know, Narendra Patel joined later. After a year and a half, or after a year, I think, then three of us remained, Binita, Chitra, and I. Claire Weeks really gave us the grounding in the kind of animation that he had been doing for 25 years at Disney. And so storyboarding was a very strong element with him. And he also introduced us to very early animation of Lotte Reiniger. And that's how I got very interested in cutouts. I used to animate leaves and sand because he showed us. But when Roger Noh came, he actually made us feel that we could also do something like that. You know, we didn't have to only sell animation. And I'll never forget the Polish animation films that we saw. They were very, you know, about the war, yeah. About, you know, what was happening in Poland. Very political also.
Auf! Nieder! Nieder!
So I then saw animation in a very different way. That's when I decided that, yeah, I'll continue doing animation for as long as I can. We used to have an annual fair just across NID. And I saw these paintings on dowry by these Madhubani artists. So I wanted to make a film with them. So my interest in working with community goes long back. But I didn't know that is what I wanted to do then, you know. So I approached them and the lady who was the, you know, who had come with them and, you know, she was in charge of the NGO, sort of said, we won't be able to animate for you, but you can buy our paintings and you give us credit in your film.
If the gift is not given, the girl is in chains. Her life, like so many, may end up in flames.
The other film I made was Summer Story, which was actually animating a story illustrated and written by my teacher, K.G. Subramaniam. So it's about a thirsty crow, but you know, he's a modern crow, so he finds a way of getting to the water, because now it's not no longer water is no longer in a pot that you can drop stones into. It's in a glass. It's in a bottle. So he gets a straw from the field and he sips it, you know. And then there was, of course, drawing, which is like every student's first film, you know, with the pencil and the eraser, which I actually get annoyed now with. But that's what I did first, yeah. But the program started in 85. When they asked us to start the program, we were like, no, we don't know enough. So Roger Noak had actually come in, you know, at a point when the institute had decided that we will start a program. And so they wanted us to have a little more grounding. So he helped us a lot, you know, thinking about this. Then because of the UNDP fellowship, we were sent abroad to various schools. That's why I went to Ghent, you know, in Belgium, to see how they teach animation over there. Initially, we were running the course once in 2 years. We were not offering the program every year. But from 89, it became a regular thing. And then we started offering it also to the undergrads as a specialization. We introduced model animation, you know, to the institute. And that gave me, because we were working that time on a huge exposition, like a permanent museum, which is there now also in the Nehru Center at Varli. The Gupta period, when the zero is supposed to have been invented, we decided to have a film there. So that's where then I chose to work in stop frame animation. And that is the film all about nothing.
Om Shunyamadaha Shunyamidam Shunya Shunyamudachyate Shunyasya Shunyamadaya Shunyameva Vashishyate.
So every 8-10 years, I feel I have to do something else in life, you know. I left to do my master's because I felt that everything that I knew, I had already taught. I didn't want to repeat myself. So I just wanted to do something different. And that study at Syracuse University really did something for me, in the sense I began to see things differently. I saw the larger picture. So I got interested in new media and interaction design also. So when I came back after a year, I introduced new media to think. But I still wanted to do animation, you know, so I made that film about my father.
Riyaz drove them to the Karachi harbor. Their gratitude had no words. They did not know what to say.
Expected to work on our projects as well. So we did a lot of work for the television. We did those channel ITs for including DD National, DD News. After all that, I felt like I wanted to do something else. And I had come across this coward. Over the years, I'd been looking at the coward. It kept appearing and disappearing from my life. So I knew it had something. I had to do something with it, but I didn't quite know what. And when I decided, okay, I should, you know, study some more, you know, so maybe I should do a PhD. So then I heard about this program at IDC. So I wrote my proposal and sent it, and that's how I came to IDC to study, actually. Coward idea, I told you, like, since 1981, I have been seeing the coward somewhere or the other. Like, first I saw it in somebody's house and I said, oh, wow, what is this? And they said, we don't know. We just have it. Somebody gave us, you know. And I was like, okay, where can I get one? And they said, Peter, so forgot. Then 1987 or 89 or something, I was traveling somewhere and I saw the coward. And I, my God, I was like, I want this. So I was able to buy it in Jaisalmer, one small one. But I had no idea what that, you know, I thought it was just a temple, you know. 98, 99, again, I went to some craftsperson's house, a fur artist actually, in Bhilwara. And I saw it again over there. And he told me that this is also red like the fur, you know, it's also a storytelling box. So I said, you know those storytellers? He said, I don't know. I think they've all vanished. But if there is anyone, I'll let you know. Then again, the time passed. Then in 2001, I was organizing a conference on storytelling at NID. Sutra, it was called. After the conference, this guy who had come with the cowards, he went and got a storyteller. So then I felt that this is coming too often in my life. I have to do something with it. While doing that, I was also making another film because I had made a commitment to the Kachi artists. So I was making a film for them about their embroidered narratives. They had made a whole lot of panels, you know, embroidered embroidery and applique work, in which they had spoken about the earthquake. Because I was studying here and I had been introduced to ethnography and things like that, I got very interested in using that approach to make that film. And what I found as a result was that, you know, making a film together with the community allows you to learn a lot about the community because you become equal partners, you know, and then there's a lot of sharing. Because of that experiment with the Kachi artists, I thought that we could also do the same with this community whom I was working with, you know, for my thesis. So it became really an interesting way because they would tell me when to put on the camera, when to switch it off, like offline, you know, I'm telling you something. So it was interesting what they would consider important to share. It became a way of knowing them. Then of course, there were so many stories that are there in the cover. I have collected 54 from one artist. If I had a chance, I would collect stories from all of them and there would be so many because they use the same image and so many multiple narratives are there, you know, with those stories. When you see the cover minus the storyteller, you don't know how to read it. But if it's filmed, you know, if those stories are animated, then in a way you are preserving the image with the text, you know, with the voice. So the original voice of the artist is not lost, you know. The story that goes with the object is not lost. So I'm more interested in intangible heritage, you know. This is an intangible heritage that you, something that is going to disappear over time. It will. It does, you know, things do disappear over time. It is one way of conserving, you know, of for future generations or somebody else ever wants to know what this was about, they should be able to see it holistically, you know, see it with the voice. So filming was, you know, making films was as a research tool, you know, using animation as a way of knowing in a community, and the other is, you know, conserving the intangible heritage. I don't know. You see, the people in the industry feel that we should train students to meet the industry standards or industry needs, but I don't think our industry is that strong or, you know, able to support the kind of talent that is there in the country. There's a lot of talent. I think at least some institutes like IDC, NID, Srishti, MIT, amongst so many others, should focus on, you know, creating or encouraging, you know, animation people who can define the industry rather than fill some gaps in the industry. Our culture has mostly been movie stars. Obviously, we have a big competition, you know. We can't compete with, you know, Aamir Khan and Salman Khan, the Khans, you know, we can't. But So, and the movie tickets are such that, you know, a family would either go to see a blockbuster, you know, Bollywood film, or see a feature animation. And that doesn't happen. So we should not look at only the movie halls as our destination points. We should look at the television. There is not much independent or, you know, good animation where you get a much more captive audience and a loyal audience. We have not looked at e-learning, which you know, unless a child is used to seeing animation and, you know, growing up with it, he's not going to grow up wanting to see, you know, anything afterwards. People like doing different things, you know. We shouldn't make it seem as if that is animation and nothing else is. If, you know, I won't be counted as an animation person in mainstream animation, whatever is mainstream. People say, "Ha, wo to waisa hai." It is not. Even my father would say, "But this is not really animation." Just because it's doesn't look, you know, it's not funny, just because it's not a feature, just because it's not showing in cinema halls that or a commercial that is well known, that we are not animators. That's not true. There's so many kinds of animation. So the industry needs to redefine, you know, what it wants to be and what it can become. You know, like Gandhiji said, there's more to life than increasing its speed. So that's what you don't have to be like the first somewhere. You don't have to be the most somewhere. You don't have to be, but you must be honest to what you do.